Thank you for tuning in to the Postmodern Realities Podcast from the Christian Research Institute and the Christian Research Journal. I'm Melanie Cogdill, Managing Editor of the Christian Research Journal. It's March 2021, and you're listening to episode 228, which is a spoiler-filled discussion of the Pixar animated film Soul, which is available on Disney+. On this episode, I'm joined by longtime journal author Robert Velarde, who is the author of several books, including A Visual Defense, Conversations with C.S. Lewis, and The Wisdom of Pixar. Robert has written an online exclusive film review article for the Christian Research Journal, and it's called, Has Pixar Lost Its Soul? Assessing an Animated Journey to the Afterlife and Back. You can read his article at our website, equip.org, if you are a subscriber to the magazine. Early access to our online exclusive articles is one of the special benefits that we give our magazine subscribers. Robert, it's good to have you on again.
It's great to be back on, Melanie.
Well, as I mentioned, we are going to have a spoiler-filled discussion of the new Pixar film Soul, which you can stream online. But tell us a little bit more about Pixar and its history, because it's now had quite a stable of films. And, you know, they are kind of expanding in the different types of subject matter that they're building films around and the different kind of characters that they have done. But, you know, take us all the way back.
Sure. Yeah, Pixar has a very interesting history. As a studio, they've been around, boy, I got to say, about 35 years now. They actually had their origins in Lucasfilm, you know, George Lucas of Star Wars. And a lot of the key individuals who started Pixar worked for George Lucas, and George Lucas really didn't know what to do with them. This was kind of at the cusp of computer technology being applied to film, and it was very new. You know, if you look at the first Star Wars film in the late 70s, a lot of those effects were actual effects. You know, they were made models, they made little explosions and all that. And this division within Lucasfilm is trying to apply computer technology, which was still, you know, not very advanced at the time. And, you know, George Lucas let them split off into their own company. And that's how Pixar got started. In fact, they used to do computer animation for a lot of television commercials, you know, very rudimentary stuff, and even sold their own high-end computer called the Pixar Imaging Computer. But, you know, their dream, I guess you could say, at Pixar was to create the first computer-generated feature film. And they had some struggles and were invested in by Steve Jobs of Apple, who put in a few million dollars to help Pixar get going. And in 1995, the first computer-generated film was Toy Story that was released. It was very successful and well-received. People were amazed not only with the technology behind the film, but that it actually told an engaging and a fun story. So Pixar now is based in Emeryville, which is in Northern California, you know, not too far from Oakland or San Francisco, San Jose, that area. So in some ways, you know, they're still divorced, I guess you could say, or separate from, you know, what would normally be the Hollywood studio scene in Southern California.
So when you think about Pixar films, and you talked about Toy Story going all the way back to 1995, which is almost 30 years ago, you know, it is different kind of animation than typically when people think of, like, say, Disney animation. It was princesses and things like that. And they just had different kinds of focuses and subject matter. And actually, I think because it's been so long, some of the adults that started out with Toy Story, probably now some of them have grandchildren that they're introducing to all these different Pixar films. So what are some of the different films? You mentioned Toy Story, and a lot of us are familiar with that. And what are the different themes that they address? Because again, it wasn't taking a classical fairy tale, like let's say Sleeping Beauty, like Disney had done, but it's making these completely different, more contemporary type of tales into animation.
Yeah, and that's a good point you bring up. You know, when Toy Story came out, Pixar deliberately didn't want it to be like a traditional Disney film. You know, of course, at the time, Disney animation was all hand-drawn, so there was that difference. But also the fact that, you know, largely Disney animated features were musicals, and Pixar didn't want to do that either. And if you look at Toy Story as their first film, you know, they really made some departures from the traditional animation expectation that audiences had. You know, it wasn't a musical. There wasn't a really clearly defined villain. It was a very different kind of film that turned out great. You know, as far as the films that Pixar has released since, you know, I address a number of them in a book I authored called The Wisdom of Pixar. And, you know, that book mostly focuses on how Pixar addresses themes of virtue, you know, what we might call classic Christian virtues. So some of the themes I cover would be, you know, justice in the movie A Bug's Life. You know, of course, that's about a bunch of ants being kind of bullied by these grasshoppers. You know, there's friendship in Toy Story 2. Finding Nemo is really about family. Incredibles covers, you know, superheroes, of course, but the topic of courage. Even Toy Story, the original, you know, is really about identity. You know, who are we? What makes us who we are? Do we have a misconception about who we are? You know, that's the main theme of Toy Story is, you know, Buzz Lightyear thinks he's something he's not. And, you know, even in an age now where there's so much discussion and even controversy about gender identity, you know, things like that, those themes, I think, are universal and engaging, and they catch our interest.
So we talked about how Pixar didn't want to have the Disney-fied approach, you know, whether it was the subject matter, like you were saying, like I was mentioning, like traditional fairy tales like Cinderella, Snow White, Sleeping Beauty, and those kinds of films that they did, but also, you know, their approach. It wasn't a musical and it was not hand-drawn. It was computer-generated. So what is the link between Pixar and Disney? Is there a link between those two companies?
Well, originally there wasn't, at least not officially. John Lasseter, who's no longer with Pixar, he used to work for Disney as an animator, but Pixar was an independent studio. You know, that all changed back in 2006 when Disney made a tremendous offer to purchase Pixar. And they did that for more than $7 billion. You know, that's billion with a B. Now, considering that Steve Jobs invested just a few million into Pixar, you know, that's quite the profit increase in Pixar Animation Studios. So what Pixar is now is a division of Disney Animation. They're still separate physically in that they're Pixar's based in Northern California. But essentially, you know, they are part of the Disney family, the Disney conglomeration, whatever you want to call it. So, for instance, if you subscribe to Disney Plus, you're going to find not only in all the Disney films there, but you'll find Pixar and Marvel and Star Wars. You know, it's sort of like, well, what doesn't Disney own at this point? So I think in some ways that partnership has been beneficial to Pixar and to Disney. In other ways, I kind of have seen Pixar maybe capitulating a little bit more to culture or to political correctness, I think, more than they would have if they had remained an independent studio. In many ways, though, I still find a lot of what Pixar creates is in a lot of ways just countercultural. It's very different than some of the other films you have out there. You know, even just the themes, and it's not like you're watching a dark Batman film. You know, it's more light and virtue and, you know, just good storytelling in general.
It seems that they always try to do something, I'm talking about Pixar, just a little bit different than we mentioned traditionally done in animation, in terms of their heroes of the film or their main characters, whether it's Up, where there's a senior citizen that's one of the main characters, or these various different toys or even emotions in Inside Out. And speaking of that film, the director for that film, Pete Docter, is also the director of the film that we're going to talk about today, which is Soul, which was also something different for them, and that is that it featured their first African-American character and really the setting in Black culture for this film, which is something that they hadn't done in their previous films. And I just wanted to mention, this is their 23rd release in more than 30 years.
Yeah, that's a great point. And Pete Docter has been with Pixar since just about the very beginning. And he's currently head of Pixar Animation Studios. Pete has directed Monsters, Inc., which really, you know, has a lot of focus on humor and joy. He directed Up, you know, the movie that's this very touching story of love. Inside Out, which you mentioned, you know, which covers emotions. So, you know, Pete seems like a very thoughtful individual, you know, now approaching soul and taking on a different topic. I've had the opportunity to visit Pixar a few times, but I haven't met Pete Docter. But, you know, knowing that he is the director kind of gives you some better context, you know, looking at what movies that he's done before. And a lot of the Pixar directors, you know, they are exclusive to directing computer animated films, you know, with a few exceptions. You know, Brad Bird has directed Incredibles and Ratatouille, but also has done, you know, some Mission Impossible and some other films, you know, as has Andrew Stanton, who directed Finding Nemo and some other Pixar movies. So, you know, Pete, as head of the studio, I think, you know, has a big responsibility as far as, you know, what direction is Pixar going to take. And, you know, in the early days of Pixar, it was very difficult to animate human beings. You know, it was just hard to get a lot of things right, including, you know, just hair and eyes and skin and all of that. It was easier to animate, you know, a toy or objects that weren't human. So animation's come a long way. Soul is, you know, as you mentioned, their 23rd film, which is kind of funny because the character in the movie Soul is named 22. And this character is in the movie, is in this place called The Great Before. So obviously 22 comes before 23. So they have some, you know, fun little hidden things in their films regularly, which is fun for fans as well.
You're listening to the Postmodern Realities podcast from the Christian Research Institute and the Christian Research Journal. Today's guest is Robert Velarde. He has written an online exclusive film review article for the Christian Research Journal, and his article is called, Has Pixar Lost Its Soul? Assessing an Animated Journey to the Afterlife and Back. You can read his article at our website, equip.org. If you're a subscriber to our magazine, and early access to our online exclusive articles like this one is one of the special benefits that we give our magazine subscribers. But if a subscription is not in your budget, we would still like you to consider to help us produce our content by giving us a tip. And a tip is just a small gift that you can give us to help us continue to bring you all this free content, something like $3 or $5 or $10, something like that. You can easily do that at our website, equip.org. If you go to magazine and at the drop-down menu, go to Postmodern Realities Podcast and hit the landing page of any episode, you will find the link there. But the biggest way you can help us is to help other people find our content by rating or reviewing our podcast. And you can do that particularly at Apple Podcasts. And it's been a while. I think we only have 2 written reviews since August. And so we would really love it if you could just spare a few moments and write a sentence or so about why you listen to the podcast and why others should listen to this podcast, but we'll take a starred review if you don't have time to do that. But the more reviews that we can get up there, the better, because then this podcast will be suggested to other people who are looking for content like this. So we thank you for all the ways in which you partner with us.
We were just talking about the director of Soul, Pete Docter, and just his history with the studio and some of the other films that he has directed for them. But tell us a little bit more about the film itself. What is Soul about?
Sure. And, you know, as you mentioned, the main character in Soul is an African-American character. His name is Joe Gardner. And Joe is, from his view, he's sort of stuck. You know, he's teaching middle school band, not too thrilled about it. His dream really is to perform as a jazz musician, to play piano. And, you know, obviously that hasn't come about for him. And, you know, Soul is really his opportunity to sort of achieve his dream. And it's sort of a roadblock is placed in front of him when he essentially he dies or he's close to death. And he's so concerned about missing this opportunity, he does everything he can to get back to Earth and be able to perform in this jazz club, you know, that evening. And a lot of what happens in between is, you know, sort of the underpinnings or backdrop of the setup for this story. And that includes, of course, well, what happens to Joe when he dies? What happens to his soul? Can he come back? Is there life after death? You know, what do we know about how this afterlife is run or administered? And, you know, a lot of those questions that are brought up, even if sometimes they're brief, you know, I think, you know, is what has drawn some attention from, you know, those who are saying, hey, this theology's a little off here. But overall, you know, the story is Joe, he wants to be a successful jazz musician. What can he do to achieve this dream? You know, has his life just been a waste?
Well, you just alluded to the next question I wanted to ask you, because this film has stirred up some controversy within Christian parenting circles in particular. And I've seen various different discussions online about particularly Christian parents feeling that this would be a detrimental film for their children to watch, especially young children, because it's not presenting a Judeo-Christian, let alone biblical, view of the afterlife, death, heaven, and hell. I mean, he even asks when he gets to the in-between place where he is, Joe wonders, is this heaven or is this, you know, H-E double hockey sticks is what the character says. And so Christian parents are worried about it. And they also are worried about not just the theological representations, but maybe more of the humanistic approach. Is it right to be talking about what is the spark within us? Shouldn't be what motivates us, you know, living for God's glory, not finding our spark. So there has been some very pointed conversations to the point of Christian parents saying, no, parents should not allow their children to watch this film. So what are some of your, you know, thoughts for Christian parents? You know, should Christians watch this film?
Yeah, and that's a great question. I remember years ago, you know, I'm the father of four children, and there was a Disney movie that had come out. I think it was called Brother Bear. And I'm like, you know, I'm not going to let my kids watch this. It was, you know, the story, as I recall, was, you know, a human person or child gets, you know, transferred, so to speak, into this body of this bear cub. And, you know, at the time I thought, well, you know, I really don't even want to go there. I don't think my kids need to watch this. You know, what are they going to get out of it? And, you know, I think a lot of Christian parents are in that position, you know, of this place of responsibility. And, you know, how do you decide, you know, what film your child should or shouldn't watch? I think every parent's situation can be a bit different, not only for their children, but even each individual child, if they have more than one, sometimes have different ways that they might, you know, respond to film or even animated film. So, you know, there's that to consider as a parent. I think one thing we need to avoid in general as Christians is just, we want to not just kind of bury our heads in the sand and entrench ourselves and kind of create this wall around us as though culture doesn't exist. You know, sooner or later, your children are going to be faced with the culture around them. And I think they'll be much better equipped to engage that culture if they've had some understanding and obviously some exposure to it. So, you know, that's one point to keep in mind. I think that in the case of Soul, you know, there's opportunities there. Do we want to discuss some of the things that are brought up in the film? You know, after you watch it, you don't want to turn it into like a homework assignment, but, you know, what did you think of that? Does this idea seem to fit with what the Bible teaches? And, you know, there's a whole lot of factors, I think, that go into that. And I think learning to, you know, understand culture, learning to interpret culture is a big part of that. And, you know, how much do we expose our children to, and what are we willing to watch with them or discuss with them, you know, as opposed to, hey, sorry, you can't watch this. And of course, as kids get older, or teenagers and whatever the age might be, you know, as soon as you tell them not to do something or they can't do something, that, of course, is the one thing they want to do. So, you know, I think it's better to be proactive in these cases and be able to openly discuss some of these ideas. And I think also in the case of Soul, we need to look, is this the big theme of the story, or are some of these questionable ideas just supporting aspects to the bigger story? You know, what is the larger theme or message that's trying to get across, you know, versus, uh-oh, we've got a few mentions here of, you know, transmigration of the soul or chakras or drum circles or things like that, which, you know, of course, do need to be addressed on some level. You know, meditation in order to enter some spiritual realm is a topic that comes up in soul. But what's the story about? You know, what are we going to learn at the end of this film that's the big message?
And I also think that because it's a film that is being streamed right now, that you can go ahead and watch it first and then see if it's appropriate for your children. I'm sure most of the parents asking this are parents of younger kids, maybe in elementary school, who enjoy animated films, especially of the Disney and Pixar type of, you know, subject matter and things like that. So it's a good way to think about it before, you know, you decide, well, hey, let's look at it ourselves as parents and then see if it's something that would be good for our kids for discussion. And so in light of that, there are various different themes that it does present about the afterlife that are not biblical. So what does it do in terms of talking about heaven and hell and, you know, those biblical concepts? And where are those concepts not biblical? And what are they teaching that wouldn't be something that we would hold to as part of a Christian worldview?
Sure. Great question. And, you know, just as a preface to my answer, when C.S. Lewis wrote a book in the 40s called The Great Divorce, which is about a bus trip to heaven from hell, he included a disclaimer, in a sense, at the beginning of the book, you know, telling people essentially, you know, this is a fantasy. You know, he wrote, I beg readers to remember that this is a fantasy. It has, of course, a moral, but the transmortal conditions are solely an imaginative supposal. They're not even a guess or speculation at what might actually await us. So we need to keep that in mind, I think, even for a film like Soul. You know, here we have a Christian author, known overtly as a Christian author, having to give a disclaimer to his fictional work about, well, hey, you really shouldn't draw a lot of ideas out of this about the reality of the afterlife. But in Soul, you know, what we have is a depiction of, well, for one, you know, we could say at least Pixar has acknowledged the reality of a soul within this fictional world. You know, in a world where naturalistic materialism is sort of on the rise, here's a film that says, hey, life doesn't end at death. There's something beyond it. The soul exists. There's consciousness that exists, and you continue. And in Soul, this is presented as an opportunity for Joe to enter the afterlife, the great beyond, I think it's called in the film. And we never really see what that is. You know, it's depicted as this escalator, you know, all lit up, kind of heading to this great light source. But Joe turns back and ends up in what Pixar calls the great before, which brings up, you know, a lot of other, you know, questionable theology as far as, you know, the great before being this place for pre-existent souls to sort of be trained or prepared before they go to earth. So that's, you know, very different than a Christian perspective. You know, one of the verses that's very good to address any kind of speculation of the afterlife is, you know, Hebrews 9:27, where we read, it is appointed for people to die once and then comes judgment. So, you know, obviously, if Soul had been biblically accurate, that would have been a very short film and not a great story. But instead, you know, we have a sort of a framework to allow them to tell their story. Now, biblically, you know, there's a whole field of study devoted to this. It's actually under the category of what we'd call eschatology, which most people think of in terms of last things, you know, how's the world going to end and all of that. But there's also elements to eschatology having to do with death, you know, our personal death, the nature of the soul and what happens to it after we die. Theologians call this the intermediate state. So we die, our physical body is dead, our soul lives on in a temporary state until, you know, as a Christian worldview teaches, until the resurrection. And then the soul is reunited with the resurrected body. So there's a whole lot of concepts and ideas in that are antithetical to, you know, all kinds of other religious perspectives or philosophies. You know, even in the early church, you know, had to address the question of Gnosticism, where the Gnostics thought or believed that the physical reality was actually bad or not to be, you know, a permanent thing, is something to be kind of shunned. and just the spirit or the soul was the good part, so to speak. But human beings are unified in this sense of immaterial and material. So, you know, upon death, Christians enter a state of like blessedness, you know, in God's presence, awaiting the return of Christ and the resurrection of the bodies. Of course, that's very different than what we have in soul. You know, we also have in soul these administrators of the afterlife that we really don't know a lot about them. You know, there's no particular mention of God or who is running this or administrating this organization. And the fact that they make mistakes, you know, obviously the God of the Bible does not make mistakes. He's infallible. But, you know, in order to tell this engaging story, it seems that just about any movie about the afterlife, there's always some kind of mistake involved. This mistake happened, and of course it allows the character to have these different adventures.
That is interesting. And one thing I'm wondering about this film, and, you know, in preparing for this interview, there was a link somewhere that I found that had an interview with Pete Docter, who said that he was a Christian. And when you go to the original link, it's been removed. So I don't know what that's about, but they reprinted what, you know, the back and forth. And he just said he's not interested in making explicitly Christian films, even as a Christian. And the thing that's interesting to me is it seems to me that there are very New Age ideas presented in this particular film, whether it's there's this area that they go to when souls are lost, and it's called the astral plane. And there's just the introduction of various different characters who had real life people who had been mentors to 22 before, like even Carl Jung and Gandhi and Mother Teresa and all these kinds of things. And so it seems like it could confuse a child, like, who are these people and what's the astral plane? Is there such thing as an astral plane? Is there such thing as lost souls? So I find it, you know, fascinating that, you know, years ago he conducted an interview saying that he was a Christian, but yet also there seems to be New Age elements of New Age mysticism in an Eastern, you know, non-Christian sense in this film.
Yeah, and I think that's a lot of it is just cultural. You know, there seems to be sort of a soft Christianity or a soft, you know, religious spirituality, you know, running through, you know, Western culture in particular. We sort of have this view that, well, pretty much everybody will end up in some sort of afterlife or heaven. It doesn't really matter, you know, as you mentioned, some of these characters that are there, you know, what their beliefs may have been. And I think that's, you know, just playing to the culture that this film is catering to in some ways. You know, and Pixar, we have to remember as well, is not setting itself up as, hey, we're going to create Christian films. You know, that's for overtly Christian filmmakers to do if they want to say that and approach films that way. But Pixar is a secular studio owned by a, you know, mega corporation, essentially Disney. And, you know, I've seen some of the discussions online where people are saying, well, Soul is heretical. And, you know, it really isn't if you take the, you know, actual definition of what heresy is. You know, you've got heresy as a term that is used for those who profess faith, but then hold to something that warps or goes against those key tenets of faith. You know, Pixar is not really in that position. They're not saying, hey, we're going to adhere to biblical ideas here. You know, it doesn't mean that some ideas in the film aren't questionable. But their purpose, you know, is to create entertaining films that are successful, that are profitable. But, you know, as I've wrote in my book, The Wisdom of Pixar, that doesn't mean that they are free of ideas that resonate with a Christian worldview. I think to a degree, we have not only common grace at work, but natural law. So we find a lot of Christian ideals in films and other, you know, forms of artwork that have their source, so to speak, in Christianity. They kind of can't help but include some of these ideas. You know, the fact that there are these New Age, as you mentioned, elements, I can think of offhand the chakras and the souls traveling around and moving from place to place and body to body, or, you know, even accessing the spiritual realm through this meditation. You know, a lot of it, the place we are in our culture, you know, it's played for kind of humorous means, I think, in Soul. But I think it also speaks to the fact that our culture is so steeped in these things that they've just become accepted, or they've just become something funny that we can mention and don't really have to think about. So, yeah, they are there. They're present in soul. But I think the overall theme of soul is something to focus on as well. You know, this is a very life-affirming movie. You know, granted, you have to have a solid foundation in your worldview that can allow life to be meaningful. And from my assessment, you know, the only worldview that can really do that is Christianity. But the fact that human beings want meaning and they want purpose out of life is true. It's something, you know, common to humanity. And as Christians, you know, we know where that comes from and we know the source. You know, Christ even said, I know who I am and where I am going. You know, whereas in a lot of cases, people don't know who they are or where they're going. They don't have a purpose or direction. And to know that life can have some more profound meaning is something that the Christian worldview is made to speak to.
And I think something that's extremely positive about the film, at least that I saw that it was positive, was, first of all, Pete Docter had a co-director, Kent Powers, who is African-American, and it really tried to, in the parts of the film that were on Earth, talk about and also embody African-American culture, specifically jazz music, but, you know, also, you know, they showed scenes at the barbershop and things like that. And I thought it was a very positive portrayal and also a really good portrayal of teachers and how teachers can make a difference in the lives of students just by persevering with them at a young age when sometimes they're not going to be world-class musicians. In this case, he's a music teacher. So I think that's something that's really positive about this film that, you know, parents should not overlook. And I think that it's a wonderful celebration specifically of music. There's just a lot of wonderful, beautiful jazz music that's in the film.
Yeah, I agree. And you know, one of the ways that we see in scripture that the followers of Christ engaged culture is they did it in a very particular way sometimes. You know, we find in Acts 17 where Paul is in Athens and, you know, he doesn't go and suddenly start berating their philosophy or their idols. You know, he begins by complimenting them or saying, hey, this is what's positive about what you're doing. That doesn't mean he doesn't end up giving them the gospel and, you know, calling them to repentance. But it does mean that he's approaching them in a way that is, well, hey, this is what I see that's positive in this. You know, one of the things I learned in graduate school is, well, you know, you look at things that you're going to criticize in the end, whether you're writing about it or speaking about it. But what can you find in it that's positive? What can you compliment it on? And, you know, as you mentioned, you mentioned the movie Soul, you know, at least acknowledges the reality of an afterlife and the soul and portrays African-American culture in a way that is seeking to be, you know, accurate or positive or beneficial. And as you mentioned, even how it portrays teachers and the, you know, the significance that they can have in the lives of students. And, you know, as someone who has an undergraduate degree in music, I appreciated a lot of the elements of music that are portrayed in the film and how it is this just wonderful art form that has so many, you know, possibilities to it. And, you know, to see soul in that sense, I think you find that there's a lot more depth to it. Sure, we've got the chakras and the Eastern mysticism and such, but we also have much that is good. And I think that is, you know, goodness flowing from God, even through secular sources to a certain degree, you know, obviously not fully, but that's what we'd call common grace.
So what about parents, Christian parents who, you know, they're on Facebook, they're seeing all the discussions among other, you know, for me, I'm seeing discussions between moms. They might feel fearful about introducing this film to their kids. So especially when we talked about some of the theology that's in it. How should they really approach this film if they're starting to feel fearful from everything, you know, other parents warning them, stay away from this film, it's dangerous to your children?
Well, I think there's a few things that can be done. I think the first one, and this goes for any Christian, whether you're a parent or not, but to really know what you believe and why you believe it, to have that foundation that you shouldn't fear another worldview, because you know that Christianity offers the best explanation of reality, and you know why it does that. You have that foundation. So I think, first of all, there's that. I think in some cases, Christian parents are just, you know, not equipped or haven't equipped themselves to have that solid Christian worldview and to be able to interact well. And frankly, it's easier to avoid something. It's easier to kind of be afraid of it and say, well, my kids shouldn't watch this, so now I don't have to deal with it. But, you know, the thing is, eventually, you know, everyone's kids grow up and they have to face these things. So I think that's the first point. Know what you believe, know why you believe it. I think the second one is harder, and that is to learn to what I call exegete the medium, learn to interpret the culture and it's what you might call its artifacts, whether that be film or television or literature, any aspect really of culture. How do we interpret it? You know, we spend, many of us, a lot of time learning biblical hermeneutics. How do we interpret the Bible? So can we apply that to our interpretation of culture? Can we look at something and instead of dismissing it or ignoring it, can we fairly evaluate it? Can we look at the context that it's in? Can we keep in mind the intent of the creators? Can we draw out from a film what it's saying rather than maybe reading in too much to it based on our own, you know, preconceptions or theological triggers, you might call them? You know, stories are very powerful, so we have to keep that in mind too. You know, children are going to remember stories far more than they might remember some lecture or presentation or something. You know, that is one reason Christ shared so many parables. You know, we have that power of story that really is the driving force behind a lot of what we consider entertainment in our culture. So it's also, I would say, helpful to have an understanding of art within a Christian framework. You know, there's a great little book by Francis Schaeffer called Art and the Bible. You know, take a couple hours to read it. Excellent introduction to how Christians can evaluate artistic works. And a lot of times we tend to focus on one aspect of a work of art or a film. We focus on the intellectual content or the worldview content, which is good that we do that. We need to understand what the ideas are. But there's more to interpreting art or understanding it than that. You know, we can maybe disagree with the film, but say, wow, this animation is technically brilliant. It's amazing how they've done this, or the acting is wonderful, or the form of this work really fits how it should be. You know, it works as a film instead of a book or something else. You know, we can ask the question, is an artist being true to himself or herself? Or are they just, you know, are they trying to cash in here and just make a buck and it doesn't really feel like it's coming across? You know, are we being, you know, nitpicky or overcritical of secondary or supporting content at the expense of the broader message of something? So, you know, I would say just trying to be gracious as well and understanding and, you know, applying the intellect God has given us to trying to understand different aspects of these things, whether, like I said, film or television or anything really. And, you know, that is not necessarily easy. You know, we are kind of in a culture where we are just consumers. We learn how to consume things. We watch things passively. We don't necessarily stop and think too much about them. And that's a whole process in and of itself to, I think, take the time to learn how to interpret culture, including film.
I want to let our listeners know that several years ago, Robert wrote a feature article for a print magazine talking about television, for example, as the new literature in terms of how people interact with culture, non-Christians, and things that they watch and really, you know, are fans of and are dedicated to. And it's a great way as a springboard for a Christian apologist to be able to talk about spiritual issues with other people that are not Christians. So I'd say to the Christian parents, if there are non-Christian parents in your neighborhood, that's a great way to have a movie night at your house and invite everyone over, because a lot of families want to see Soul. It's the new hotness from Pixar. And yet it's a great way to have a movie discussion after, even with the kids present, and talk about some of the themes in there and be able to talk about a Christian worldview. And yet, as I mentioned, you know, there's a lot of Christian parents warning other Christian parents not to see this film. And a typical thing that you might see, and you talked about it earlier in the podcast, is you know, Soul is promoting heretical teachings. So do you think Soul is heretical? Do you think a Christian can say at the end of this, well, it is heretical. It's not Christian at all in its teachings of the afterlife.
Well, you know, as I mentioned earlier, you know, heresy, it really has to be from a source of someone who has already professed faith. And Pixar hasn't done that. I think from a Christian perspective, there are heretical ideas in Soul. But to call it heresy, I think, is going a bit too far since, you know, as I said, we're dealing with a secular studio here. But, you know, that does present us with an opportunity to understand a little bit better about the afterlife. You know, kids in particular are very curious. You know, what happened to grandma or grandpa when they died? Where did they go? Where are they? You know, what happens after death to the soul? And, you know, there are a number of ways of approaching those kind of questions. And, you know, as I mentioned, one of them is learning to understand and know what you believe and why you believe it. So, you know, any solid evangelical systematic theology book, you know, you turn to a section on eschatology, you read through a section on death and the soul and the afterlife. And, you know, frankly, biblically speaking, we don't have a whole lot of data. There's just far too much speculation, I think, on our part as to what happens after we die. We know the rudiments, I guess you could say. The soul lives on. The soul of the Christian enters God's presence. And in this intermediate state, we await the resurrection where the soul is joined with the body again. So there are some, you know, rudimentary understandings that we have, you know, gleaned from the Bible. But we need to be careful, too, to just avoid too much speculation. You know, these sorts of, you know, I had this near-death experience, and this is what I saw, and, you know, people writing about these things. And it's like, well, you know, biblically speaking, the canon is closed. We have all the revelation that God wanted us to have about this. You know, to fixate too much, I think, on any one area of doctrine, you know, could just divert us from what's really important. You know, do we spend all our time studying angelology, for instance, and angels? Or, you know, are we better served living our lives, glorifying God, understanding Christ and his nature? So you kind of have to weigh these things. And, you know, better understanding of eschatology as it applies to the soul and death and life after death, I think is, you know, one thing that parents can do for sure to try to guide their children and say, well, you know, this is what the Bible teaches about this. This is why this makes more sense than a competing view.
So just to wrap it up, you know, is there a central theme of the film, and does that theme at all resonate with Christianity and something that Christians can say, well, this is positive. This is a positive aspect of this film.
Yeah, I think so. You know, Soul is really about life and, by inference, you know, living life well, making the most of life, which includes even our daily common experiences. You know, in the movie, they talk about just taking a walk or sky watching. You know, it's not simply spending all one's time trying to achieve one particular purpose or goal. So in that sense, it's a very life-affirming story. You know, with that said, not all worldviews provide a robust foundation for meaning in life. You know, atheism doesn't. You know, what is the meaning of life for the atheist? There's no real lasting purpose if, in the end, you're just, you know, the product of matter and you're going to cease to exist in every way. Whereas, you know, with Christianity, we have this foundation. We have a God who exists, a God who is personal, a God who is transcendent, yet also active in his creation, who cares about us personally, and who has promised to overcome evil at some point forever. So there's a whole lot going on there in support of a claim that life matters. And, you know, Christianity offers that strong foundation.
Well, finally, I want to end with some fun rapid fire questions for Robert. So Robert, do you like ice in your drinks or no ice?
Oh, ice in my drinks in the summer for sure, but not when it gets too cold.
And speaking of cold, we are recording in March. There's been a lot of crazy weather in the United States. So rain or snow?
Snow, yeah. And I've got to say, you know, I'm a native Southern Californian, but have lived in Colorado for, boy, almost 25 years. And as long as I don't have to be out driving in it, I enjoy the snow for sure.
plastic paper or bring your own bags to the grocery store? Well, I guess pre-COVID, before when we could do some of these things.
Well, in the age of COVID now, it's whatever they bring out to the vehicle to load into it when we pick up groceries. So I don't know that I have a preference, you know.
And speaking of that, it sounds like you're ordering your groceries online, but before you did that, do you prefer self-checkout or just old school with the cashier?
Oh, I'm self-checkout. Yeah, I'm a high introvert, so the least I have to interact with people is better for me. Although, as a writer, you know, it's a little easier. I write things and then they're out there.
Well, thanks, Robert, for being a guest again on the Postmodern Realities podcast.
Thanks so much for having me back on.
You've been listening to the Postmodern Realities podcast from the Christian Research Institute and the Christian Research Journal. Today's guest has been longtime journal writer Robert Velarde, who has written an online exclusive film review article for the Christian Research Journal, and his article is called, "Has Pixar Lost Its Soul? Assessing an Animated Journey to the Afterlife and Back." You can read his article at our website, equip.org, if you are a subscriber to our magazine. We'd like to connect to you, so please subscribe to the Bible Answer Man YouTube channel and join in the conversation in the comments section and in the live chat when we have premiere videos. Please follow the Bible Answer Man page on Facebook and on Twitter. You will find us at Hank Hanegraaff, Bible Answer Man, Christian Research Institute, and Christian Research Journal, as well as on Instagram at the Bible Answer Man account. You won't want to miss every Monday through Friday at 6 p.m. Eastern when we live stream the Bible Answer Man broadcast, hosted by CRI President Hank Hanegraaff at our website, equip.org. In addition, please subscribe to the Hank Unplugged podcast. Hank gets out of the studio and into his study and engages in in-depth, free-flowing, essential Christian conversations on critical issues with some of the most interesting, informative, and inspirational people on the planet. You'll want to head on over to equip.org because there you're going to find thousands of free resources for you in articles and past broadcasts, our podcasts, and videos. And thank you for all the ways in which you partner with the Christian Research Institute.